Chapter 3. Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, Yea, hath God said, Ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden? And the woman said unto the serpent, We may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God hath said, Ye shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it, lest ye die. And the serpent said unto the woman, Ye shall not surely die. For God doth know that in the day ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof, and did eat, and gave also unto her husband with her, and he did eat. And the eyes of them both were opened, and they knew that they were naked. And they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves aprons. And they heard the voice of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God amongst the trees of the garden. And the Lord God called unto Adam and said unto him, Where art thou? And he said, I heard thy voice in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, and I hid myself. And he said, Who told thee that thou wast naked? Hast thou eaten of the tree whereof I commanded thee that thou shouldest not eat? And the man said, The woman whom thou gavest to be with me, she gave me of the tree, and I did eat. And the Lord God said unto the woman, What is this that thou hast done? And the woman said, The serpent beguiled me, and I did eat. And the Lord God said unto the serpent, Because thou hast done this, thou art cursed above all cattle and above every beast of the field. Upon thy belly shalt thou go, and dust shalt thou eat all the days of thy life. And I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. Unto the woman he said, I will greatly multiply thy sorrow and thy conception. In sorrow thou shalt bring forth children. And thy desire shall be to thy husband, and he shall rule over thee. And unto Adam he said, Because thou hast hearkened unto the voice of thy wife, and hast eaten of the tree of which I commanded thee, saying, Thou shalt not eat of it, cursed is the ground for thy sake. In sorrow shalt thou eat of it all the days of thy life. Thorns also and thistles shall it bring forth to thee, and thou shalt eat the herb of the field. In the sweat of thy face shalt thou eat bread, till thou return unto the ground. For out of it wast thou taken, for dust thou art, and unto dust shalt thou return. And Adam called his wife's name Eve, because she was the mother of all living. Unto Adam also, and to his wife, did the Lord God make coats of skins, and clothed them. And the Lord God said, Behold, the man is become as one of us to know good and evil. And now, lest he put forth his hand and take also of the tree of life, and eat, and live forever. Therefore the Lord God sent him forth from the garden of Eden to till the ground from whence he was taken. So he drove out the man, and he placed at the east of the garden of Eden cherubims and a flaming sword which turned every way to keep the way of the tree of life.
I just want to say that it's an honor and privilege to be able to preach unto y'all this morning. Where I wanted to start it there was in Genesis chapter number 3, verse 1. Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, Yea, hath God said? And Jesus answered him, saying, It is written that man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word of God. Now, it took a while for Jesus Christ to rebuke that devil, to rebuke that demon, but in Luke chapter 4:4, the first time he responds to the devil, he rebukes him and says that we're supposed to live by every word of God. We start off the Bible with the foundation of God creating the entire world with what? His words. And God said. Then we see the first attack is at the very beginning. What does the devil attack? The Word of God. This is the title of the sermon tonight, today, Every Word of God. Now go to Revelation chapter 19, if you would. Now think with me for a second. What was Adam tempted with for the first sin? Food. He was tempted with food. And what does Satan do to Jesus Christ when he's in the wilderness? He says, command these stones that they be made bread. And he's tempting him with food. You think that's a coincidence? No. The main agenda of the devil is to attack God's word. That's the big battle today. The epic battle is against the truth and against the father of lies. It's against spiritual wickedness. It's against the deceiver. Pardon me for a second. Either way. Look at Revelation chapter 19, verse 13. It says, and he was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. And the armies which were in heaven followed him upon white horses, clothed in fine linen, white and clean. And out of his mouth goeth a sharp sword, and with it he should smite the nations. And he shall rule them with a rod of iron. And he treadeth the winepress of the fierceness and wrath of Almighty God. So we see Jesus Christ rebukes Satan with his word, but then he's going to destroy him with his word too. The Word of God is the beginning, it's the end, it's everything. The Bible says in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Jesus Christ is a two-edged sword. He himself is going to use his words to destroy Satan. So this is a very important doctrine. Go, if you would, to Psalms chapter 11. But you know, today, Christians are weak in this battle. Christians are weak on standing on the Word of God. And I would argue that this is the most important doctrine. And I'm going to prove that from the Bible. Look at Psalms chapter 11, verse 3. If the foundations be destroyed, what can the righteous do? That's a good question. If we don't have the Word of God, what can we do? Can we go soul winning? Can we draw near to God? Can we read his word? Can we study his word? Can we know how to live? Can we be saved? Go to Romans chapter 10. The Bible says in Psalms 138, for thou hast magnified thy word above all thy name. Go to Romans chapter 10. It says, how then shall we call, how shall they call on him in whom they have not believed? And how shall they believe in him in whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? And how shall they preach except they be sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel of peace and bring glad tidings of good things. But they have not all obeyed the gospel. For Isaiah saith, Lord, who hath believed our report? So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. How is someone going to get saved without the word of God? It's impossible. How are they going to call on him if they don't believe? How are they going to believe if no one goes and preaches it to them? How are they going to get it preached to them if no one's sent? And most importantly, how are they going to have faith without the word of God? Faith cometh by the word of God. If we don't have the word of God, how can anybody get saved? Right. It's the foundation. And even if you look at a lot of doctrinal statements, usually the first point is talking about, hey, we believe the Bible. We believe it's inerrant. It's the word of God. But you know what they leave off? Where you can find it. They just say generically the Bible. And what I'm going to prove is the King James Bible is the every word of God today. Go to Ephesians chapter 2. Says in John chapter 15, verse 5, I am the vine, ye are the branches. He that abideth in me, and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. For without me, ye can do nothing. We can do nothing without Christ. And Christ is the word of God. We can't do anything without this book. Look at Ephesians chapter 2, verse 12. That at that time you were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope, and without God in the world. Man without the Bible, man without Jesus Christ, is without hope. There's no hope. But guess what? There is hope today. It's the King James Bible. It's every word of God. That's where we get our hope. Go to Genesis chapter 1. Go all the way back. We're going to turn to a lot of scripture today. And you know, when it comes to the doctrine of preservation, the doctrine of understanding why we believe the Bible, there's a lot of arguments. There's a lot of ways that you could prove this is the Word of God. There's a lot of different things you could talk about. But I find when you talk to somebody that's, you know, kind of ignorant of this position or hasn't heard of it very much, it's difficult to bring up all the manuscript evidence and talk about Codex Vaticanus and, you know, Codex Aleph and all these other things. I mean, it's hard to take that with you and show them all these examples. I believe you can prove it from the internal evidence of the Bible. And I think that would be one of the best ways to do it. So I want to focus this sermon on every word of God, because that's going to be the focus. So I have the first point. Why do I believe the Bible? Why do I believe the King James Bible? Well, the first point is it claims to be the Word of God. You know, not every book claims to be the Word of God. I mean, there's a lot of famous titles out there. It was the best of times. It was the worst of times. You know, there's books like Call Me Ishmael. These books aren't even claiming to be the Word of God, of course, right? If you just whittled it down to the ones that are even claiming to be the Word of God, you're going to have a small list. And you know what doesn't fall on that list? The NIV. It doesn't even claim to be the Word of God. It's a dynamic equivalence. It says, well, we took a sentence and tried to transform it into a sentence that we thought was similar. Thought for thought, or meaning for meaning. It doesn't even claim to be every word. It's not a word-for-word translation. So it can't even be the Word of God. It can't be every word of God. It's impossible. If you believe what Jesus Christ said, that man is supposed to live by every single word, the question is, where is it? Because it's not the NIV. They won't even claim that it's every single word. But look at Genesis chapter 1. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. What an opening to a book. We see that it's God. He's saying, this is a book from God. Go to Revelation chapter 1 now. Now, there's something that's called the burden of proof. This is kind of a term for like law, for law or in a court. The burden of proof, when someone makes a claim, they are granted that it is true unless someone can give a reasonable explanation of why it would be false. And at which point that they can attack the statement that you made, the burden of proof shifts back to yourself, and now you have to prove your claim. Well, the Bible is claiming that it's the Word of God. It's claiming that it's the truth. So until someone can give some kind of reasonable evidence not to believe it, they have the burden of proof, not the Bible. The Bible has the claim. Look at Revelation chapter 1, verse 1. The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave unto him, to show unto his servants things which must shortly come to pass, and he sent and signified it by his angel unto his servant John. See again, Jesus, this is the revelation of Jesus Christ, the one claiming to be God. It's not just some guy that made it up. It's not like the Book of Mormon that says, I, Nephi, and it goes on to tell his little stupid story. That's false. No, this is the words of God. This is the words of Jesus Christ. It's saying it. Go to Revelation 22 now. So the burden of proof is on someone else. It's not on the Bible. It's claiming to be the Word of God. It's not misleading. I think most people would not struggle with this point. I think if you asked even an atheist, hey, is the Bible claiming to be God's word? They would say yes. I would say most of the time. But it's important to understand that it is claiming to be the Word of God. Look at Revelation 22:18. For I testify unto every man that heareth the words of the prophecy of this book, if any man shall add unto these things, God shall add unto him the plagues that are written in this book. And if any man shall take away from the words of this of the book of this prophecy, God shall take away his part out of the book of life and out of the holy city, and from the things which are written in this book. He which testifieth these things saith, surely I come quickly, amen. Even so come, Lord Jesus, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all, amen. So we see, God takes the word seriously. He says, you're supposed to live by every single word. And if you take a word out, I'm going to take your part out of the book of life. That's pretty serious. I don't think we should, oh, I got a thought for thought translation. Oh, I got a, you know, dynamic equivalence. I got just a paraphrase. That's scary. Yeah. I mean, this is saying, hey, I'm going to take your part of the book of life. I'm not going to mess around with God's word. Go to 1 John chapter 5 now. I'm having you turn to a lot of places, but this is very important. The Bible uses this phrase 415 times. Thus saith the Lord. That's not a phrase you find in a lot of books. That's not in Hop on Pop. The Bible is saying, thus saith the Lord. That's a lot of authority there. In Genesis chapter 20, before the Ten Commandments, it says, and God spake all these words, saying. The Bible is clear that it's the God's word. It's what he's telling us. It's what he's instructing us. Now, you could be like Pharaoh, and Pharaoh said, who is the Lord that I shall obey his voice to let Israel go? I know not the Lord, neither will I let Israel go. You know, a lot of people will reject that it's the word of God. We should understand this is the word of God. Whether or not you reject it or not, let's just determine first, hey, is this the Word of God? Because sometimes you go out soul winning or you'll talk to people and they'll just say, I don't believe the Bible's God's Word. Well, it's going to be really hard to get that person saved. I mean, I don't even want to waste my time with someone that's just going to reject the fact that it's God's Word.
Right.
It's going to be spinning your wheels. Look at 1 John 5, verse 9. If we receive the witness of men, the witness of God is greater. For this is the witness of God which he hath testified of his Son. Now, when I go soul winning, I always use this part. And I say, look, if you can believe what somebody will tell you, if you can believe what your parents will tell you, if you can believe what a teacher will tell you, if you can believe what the news will tell you, what the president will tell you, you can believe the Word of God that much more. The witness of God is greater witness than any person. And there's no person alive today that's older than this book. This book is an older witness than every person on this planet. Look at verse 10. He that believeth on the Son of God hath the witness in himself. He that believeth not God hath made him a liar, because he believeth not the record that God gave of his Son. And this is the record that God hath given to us, eternal life, and his life is in his Son. God's record has always existed. And it's about getting people to believe his record, to believe his word, to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. Christ is the word. That's what we're believing. So the first point, if I'm going to try to prove to somebody that this is the Bible, the King James Bible is every word of God, well, it claims to be. I mean, how can you argue that it's not claiming to be God's word? That would just be ignorant of all the Bible, of virtually every verse in the Bible. Go to Deuteronomy chapter 30. So the second point would be, why do I believe the King James Bible? Well, accessibility. There's not very many books that claim to be the Word of God that have the accessibility like this book. In fact, there's no book that has the accessibility of the King James Bible. It says in Deuteronomy 4, verse 29, but if from thence thou shalt seek the Lord thy God, thou shalt find him, if thou seek him with all thy heart and with all thy soul. Look at Deuteronomy 30, verse 10. If thou shalt hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God to keep his commandments and his statutes which are written in this book of the law, and if thou turn unto the Lord thy God with all thine heart and with all thy soul, for this commandment which I command thee this day is not hidden from thee, neither is it far off. It is not in heaven that thou shouldest say, who shall go up to heaven? Go up for us to heaven and to bring it unto us, that we may hear it and do it. Neither is it beyond the sea that thou shouldest say, who shall go over the sea for us and bring it unto us, that we may hear it and do it. Keep your finger and go to Romans chapter 10. So he's saying it's not hidden from you. Neither is it far off. It's not in heaven where you have to have somebody go up there and get it for you. It's not in the sea. You have to go down in the sea and try and find it. Look at Romans 10 verse 8. But what saith it? The word is nigh thee, even in thy mouth and thy heart. That is the word of faith which we preach. You know what? I don't believe that there's a person that doesn't ever hear John 3:16. And John 3:16 clearly says that God loves the world, that he sent his Son. Right? I mean, you can either believe that claim or you cannot believe that claim. But the burden of proof is on you. What are you going to do with that verse? When you hear John 3:16, what is the decision you're going to make? Everybody has that decision to make, don't they? To believe the truth, to believe in Jesus Christ, to be saved, to have everlasting life, or to not. The word's not far off. Oh, there's this guy, you know, in the jungle that's never heard the Bible. I don't believe it.
Amen.
The word is nigh thee. Go back and let's look at verse 14 to finish off Deuteronomy 30. See if it says something a lot different. Verse 14, but the word is very nigh unto thee, in thy mouth and in thy heart, that thou mayest do it. The Bible has always been ready for man to hear. Man's always heard God's word, but he chooses to reject it. It's not a question of, well, they never get a chance. I believe, you know, the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so they're without excuse. God is just obvious. And anybody that seeks him will find him. So I looked an article. Now, I'm using the Bible to prove that the Bible is accessible. But even if you just look at the secular world today, it'll say from 1815 to 1975, there was 2.5 billion copies of the King James Bible made. 2.5 billion. It's estimated that there's more than 5 billion copies in the world today. I mean, that's almost one per person. And you think about it, most people don't live by themselves. There's a lot of families and people living together. I mean, there's more than enough Bibles to go to every single person, for every single person to have a copy. If you look at the next best-selling book in the world, it's called Quotations from the Works of Mao Zedong. It was distributed in 1966. So in communist China, the emperor there, whatever you want to call him, he basically made it mandatory that every person in the entire country have a copy of his book. So that he could teach them, you know, communism and economic, you know, structure from communism, social structure, culture, education, army, politics. But you know what happened from that? It's called the Great Leap Forward. There was 45 million people slaughtered in 4 years. And that book's not claiming to be the Word of God. So let's keep going down the list of the most accessible books we have. Number 3, Harry Potter. What trash. You know, I hated those movies. I hate that book. It's witchcraft. It's wicked. Amen. It has nothing to do with God. It's ungodly. There's no such thing as a good witch, as a good wizard. It's all wickedness. Number 4, The Lord of the Rings. Number 5, The Alchemist. Number 6, The Da Vinci Code. Oh, a book blaspheming Jesus Christ, attacking the deity of Jesus Christ? These sound like books written by another author. The serpent attacking God's word. Is that surprising that it's at the top of the list? The Twilight Saga. Another. Number 8, Gone with the Wind. I guess those love romance novels, you know. Number 9, Think and Grow Rich. That makes me think of a verse. But they that will be rich fall into temptation and a snare and in many foolish and hurtful lusts which drown men in destruction and perdition. Number 10, The Diary of Anne Frank. Let's just propagate that lie some more. Go to Psalms chapter 19. The Bible says, so then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Does everybody have a chance? Yes. It even says that in Romans 10. It says, but I say, have they not heard? Yes, verily, their sound wins all the earth, and their words unto the ends of the world. So you can say, oh, you know, my high school teacher told me that there's all kinds of people in the world that have never heard of Christianity. They don't know who Jesus is. Or you can believe what the Bible says. You can believe the internal evidence of the Bible that's saying it's gone to the ends of the world. Right. Everybody knows. Right. Everybody has a chance. Look at Psalms 19, verse 1. The heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament showeth his handiwork. Day into day uttereth speech, and night into night showeth knowledge. There is no speech nor language where their voice is not heard. Their line has gone out through all the earth, and their words to the end of the world. In them hath he set a tabernacle for the sun, which is a bridegroom coming out of his chamber, and rejoiceth the strong man to run a race. His going forth is from the end of the heaven, and his circuit unto the ends of it, and there is nothing hid from the heat thereof. The law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. Look, there's no language or speech that can't see the handiwork of God, that can't see his creation. And if you seek him, you'll find his word, and you can know how to be saved. You expect me to believe everybody hears the gospel? Yes. That's what the Bible says. I'm not going to trust in my own wisdom. I'm not going to lean on some, you know, college professor or some person that tells me no. No, I'm going to lean on what the Bible says. Go to Romans chapter 1, if you would. I believe that everyone has a chance to hear the gospel. Everybody knows who God is. This doesn't exist. This lie of, oh, there's all these people that don't know where God is. They reject the truth. Look at Romans chapter 1, verse 16. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God and the salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also the Greek. A lot of people would attack Christianity. They would say, you believe that people that never, you know, believe in Jesus Christ are going to hell? Say, yes. Every single one of them. All of them. I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. You either believe or you're damned. That's it. And as much if we get that in our heart, it'll encourage us to go out and preach the gospel harder. When we realize, hey, the only hope they have is with Jesus Christ, is the word of God. Because without him, they have no hope. There's no hope apart from the word of God. Look at verse 17. For therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith. As it is written, the just shall live by faith. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness, because that which may be known of God is manifest in them. For God has showed it unto them. For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even to the eternal power and Godhead, so that they were without excuse, because that when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish heart was darkened. If somebody I'm talking to at a door tells me they're an atheist, or I don't believe the Bible, or I don't believe in heaven, I just quote them Romans 1:20 every single time. Amen. Hey, you don't have an excuse. You can clearly see that God exists. I know that you know God exists. Yep. I'm not necessarily going to be really mean to the person. I'm just going to say, hey, look, the Bible makes it clear that everybody knows God exists. And that you have no excuse. Are you sure I can't just show you a few more verses? Are you sure I can't just show you what the Bible says? Can I just show you why I believe the Bible? Because they don't have an excuse. Go to Acts chapter 15. What about in the Old Testament? I mean, could they have the word, God's word in the Old Testament? Yes, they could. It said the law of the Lord is perfect at converting the soul. Look at Acts chapter 15, verse 21. For Moses of old time hath in every city them that preach him, being read in the synagogues every Sabbath day. God's word is always being preached. People always have a chance to hear God's word. Yep. Romans chapter 3, verse 19 says, now we know that what things soever the law saith, it saith to them that are under the law, that every mouth may be stopped and all the world may become guilty before God. Why do I believe the King James Bible is the word of God? Because accessibility. God's making it clear everybody has a chance to hear God's word. Everybody has a chance to be saved. Well, where's that book at? How about the most popular book ever in human history that'll never be, topped? It's not going to be topped by Harry Potter. Right. I don't care what stupid fantasy you build up in your mind. It's never going to replace God's words. Because right. God's words is what has the power, not man's words. Go to Isaiah chapter 59. So far we've learned what? The Bible claims to be the word of God. It's accessible. Third reason, it's preserved. The preservation of the Bible. And there's so many verses on this. I'll read for you from 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 23. Being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible, by the word of God, which liveth and abideth forever. For all flesh is as grass, and all the glory of man is the flower of grass. The grass withereth, and the flower thereof falleth away. But the word of the Lord endureth forever. And this is the word which by the gospel is preached unto you. Look at Isaiah 59, verse 21. As for me, this is my covenant with them, saith the Lord. My spirit that is upon thee, and my words which I have put in thy mouth, shall not depart out of thy mouth, nor out of the mouth of thy seed, nor out of the mouth of thy seed's seed, saith the Lord, from henceforth forever. Go to 2 Peter chapter 1. So he's saying in Isaiah, hey, the words that I give you, your kids are going to say, and their kids are going to say, forever. So my question is, where are the words of Isaiah? Where are these words? They're right here. Amen. We have them. Right. Proverbs chapter 30, verse 5. Every word of God is pure. He is a shield on them that put their trust in him. Add thou not unto his words, lest he reprove thee, and thou be found a liar. The Bible says in John chapter 10, verse 35, if he called them gods unto whom the word of God came, and the scripture cannot be broken. The scripture can't be broken. Amen. Look at 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 18. And this voice which came from heaven we heard when we were with him in the holy mount. We have also a more sure word of prophecy, whereunto you do well that ye take heed, as unto a light that shineth in a dark place, until the day dawn and the day star arise in your hearts, knowing this verse, that no prophecy of the scripture is of any private interpretation. For the prophecy came not in old time by the will of men, but holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. Now think about this, okay? He's saying, even if Jesus Christ were in the flesh talking with us, and you saw that, this Bible is a more sure word of prophecy.
Right.
Think about that. Even if you had Jesus Christ in the flesh preaching you the Bible, that experience does not trump the word of God, because right. The scripture cannot be broken.
That's right.
He's saying, even though I saw him in the Holy Mount, he was transfigured before my eyes, he ascended up into heaven, I have more confidence in the Bible. I have more confidence in the Word of God. What? Let's get out the NIV. Let's have a lot of confidence in the NIV and the HIV and, the NASB and all these stupid versions. I have no confidence in those books. Right. They're not every word of God. They don't even claim to be it. Go to Psalms chapter 12. Matthew 5 says, "For verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass, one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law till all be fulfilled." Deuteronomy 8:3, "And he humbled thee and suffered thee to hunger and fed thee with manna, which thou knewest not, neither did thy fathers know, that he might make thee know that man doth not live by bread only, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of the Lord doth man live." That's where we get the quote in Luke chapter 4. So if he wants us to live by every single word that proceedeth out of the mouth of the Lord, you know what this does? It destroys all those stupid charismatics with their private interpretations. With their private, "Oh, God told me this, and God told me that. God told me something in my, you know, prayer today, but I'm not going to share that with you." Well, it tells me I need to learn by every single word that proceeds out of the mouth of the Lord.
Right.
So if he told you something, I need to know it. But how stupid would that be? I have to find every single one of these charismatic preachers and find out what all of them said so that I can live by God's word? Doesn't make any sense. No, it's this book. I'm not going to get up and tell you God gave me some private interpretation. No, they're all right here.
Amen.
It's every word of God, so you can live. Look at Psalms 12, verse 6. "The words of the Lord are pure words, as silver tried in a furnace of earth, purified seven times. Thou shalt keep them, O Lord. Thou shalt preserve them from this generation forever." So who is it that preserves God's word? Is it man? Is it the scribe? Is it the translator? It's God.
Amen.
So if you're going to say that we don't have a perfect Bible today, you know you're attacking? Not man, God.
Right.
You say, "Oh, I don't believe man could do that right." It's not in man's hands.
Right.
It's in God's hands.
Right.
Thou shalt preserve it.
Right.
If you say you don't believe in an every word Bible, you just don't believe the Bible. Let's just make it clear.
Amen.
Let's just make it plain. You can't say that and say you believe the Bible.
Right.
Matthew 24:35. "Heaven and earth shall pass away, but my word shall not pass away."
Amen.
Oh, we got to dig it up and find it. Oh, hopefully we'll get it right one year. No, there's only one option. I helped you try to remember this by cap. It claims to be the word of God. It's accessible. It's preserved. These would be the three ways that I would show somebody. If I get somebody and they're not really sure if it's the word of God, but they're still kind of interested, I might show them some verses from the Bible. Hey, it claims to be the word of God. Hey, it's saying it's accessible in Romans chapter 10. Hey, it's showing it's preserved. Do you believe God would tell you you're supposed to live by every word of God if he didn't give it to you? You know, there's actually been people that were a little hesitant, a little not sure, that showing them the word of God actually cleared it up for them. It wasn't my words. I can't explain to them, "Oh, you know, this is why I believe." No, it's just I'm going to show you words from God's own book. The internal evidence of the Bible proves that it's the word of God, without error. I don't need to come up with some fancy illustration for myself or analogy. I'll just show you God's words. It claims to be the word of God. It's accessible to everybody, and it's been preserved. Go to 2 Corinthians chapter 2. Now, I want to drive in why that's important. Why is it important that we believe it's every single word of God? You know why? It's an authority issue. If you don't believe that the King James Bible is every word of God, you don't have another authority. You are your own authority. That's why it's so important. Because all these people that read all these other versions, you know, the NIV or, you know, whatever it is they want to use, the book of the month, right? They're their own authority. They decide if the verse that they're reading is actually God's word or not.
Right.
Well, did it really say that? I don't think so. Let me get the NASB. No, let me get the ESV. No, let me get the Message. Because you can get whatever you want out of the Message.
Right.
That's complete trash.
Yes.
But you know what? There's Christians today that actually use the Message and actually think it's somehow legitimate. But you know what they're saying? I want to be my own authority. I want to trust in myself. I want to determine what God really said. Look at 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 17. "For we are not as many which corrupt the word of God, but as of sincerity, but as of God, in the sight of God, speak we Christ." You know what's another proof that the King James Bible is the word of God? The fact that the NIV exists. The fact that the NASB exists. The fact that the ESV, there's so many corruptions of the word of God. They're everywhere.
Right.
But you know, most Christians today think that they're all the Bible. My question is, where are the multiple corruptions? You say, "Oh, it's the NWT. It's the New World Translation Jehovah's Witness use." Look, there's not that many people that use that book. That's not, I mean, it's just a cult.
Right.
But you know, there's a lot of people that use the NIV. So a lot of people use the ESV. So a lot of people use all these modern versions. I mean, there's tons of them out there. That would make more sense, wouldn't it? So go all the way back to Luke 4, if you would. You say, how is it an authority issue? I mean, if they're reading the NIV and they think that that's, you know, somehow authoritative, isn't that going to still be their authority? Aren't they shifting the authority to them? No. I'm going to prove that. Look at Luke 4:4. We'll read it again. And Jesus answered him, saying, it is written that man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word of God. Now you stay there. Let me read for you the NIV, that verse. Jesus answered, it is written, man shall not live on bread alone. Notice something missing? Isn't that a coincidence? It's missing every word of God.
Right.
They couldn't figure out how to translate it into a new sentence. They were like, well, this isn't every word of God, so let's just drop it. How inconspicuous. I'll read you from the message. Jesus answered by quoting Deuteronomy, it takes more than bread to really live. Yeah, you got to really live. Got to get more than bread. How stupid. But you know, I even got a text message from a family member saying, oh, I really like how this one's worded, and then gave me the message. Proving the fact there are Christians out there that claim to use the message, that think it has some kind of a, you know, legitimate authority. It's ridiculous. You can't, how could you say the a dynamic equivalence or a paraphrase is God's word when he made it so clear the words are what's important,
right?
Not the thoughts, not you getting it kind of close a little bit. I'll read for you a couple other phrases from the message. In the King James Bible in John 1, it says, the only begotten Son. The message says, this one-of-a-kind God expression. In Galatians 3:2, the King James Bible says, the works of the law. The message says, working your heads off to please God. Wow, this is really edifying. Just working my head off, man. How do you get saved? Working your head off. Stupid. Romans chapter 10, verse 13. Is this an important verse? For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. The message. Everyone who calls help God gets help. Ridiculous. But people still use this trash. You know what? I'm not going to stop preaching against the message until they're all burned. Because it's just stupid and wicked. And people still try to use it. But you know, I think a lot of Christians, they say, oh, you're using the message. Of course that's stupid. Of course that's wrong. So if you can establish that that's definitely wrong, okay, then the question is, how much wrong is wrong? What about the NIV? What about somewhere in the middle? I'll read for you one more. Go to Mark chapter 1. I'll give you one more message for fun. Mark chapter 1, verse 15, and saying, the time is fulfilled, the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent ye and believe the gospel. The first words he speaks in Mark, repent ye and believe the gospel. Change what you're believing in and trust in Christ alone.
Amen.
That's what it says. What does the message say? Time's up. God's kingdom is here. Change your life and believe the message.
Wow.
Believe the message? That's some strange wording.
Yeah.
Hey, believe the message. Came from the message. Change your life. That's what they change repentance to. If you read James 2 in the message, it's just hardcore work salvation.
Right.
They say believe and working is exactly the same. It's trash.
Amen.
So I have an object lesson. I need a couple volunteers. We're going to establish why the authority issue is so important. Dominique, can you help me? Brother Lone, can you help me? So what I need you to do, Dominique, is I have a slinky here, okay? And I need you to measure the pulpit, its width. But you can only use terms of measurement of the slinky. So you can't use inches or feet. You have to use this slinky. I want you to give me a measurement real quick. How wide is this pulpit?
I don't know.
You don't know?
I can't.
How about, would you say it's about a slinky?
A slinky
link width? Yeah, okay. Let's say it's about a slinky, right? Okay. Now, here's the problem with that, okay, is, Dustin, take this for me. Now, just start walking this way. Here's my question. Is that a slinky length? So now, who is determining what the width is? Is it the slinky or is it me? It's me. There's no authority. isn't there? So I have another tool. Here's a measuring tape. Dominique, why don't you go ahead and measure the width of this pulpit? What does it say?
We got 40 and 5/8.
40 and 5/8. All right, Dustin, go ahead and measure that pulpit for me. How wide is it?
I think I already knew how wide it was.
I just
40 and 5/8.
Prove all things, right? Okay, you can sit down. Now here's a question. Who was the authority there? Was it Dominique or Brother Lone? Or was it the ruler? It's the ruler, isn't it? That's why it's so important. Because the person that doesn't use the King James Bible, they're the authority. Not the tool they're using, because the tool's garbage.
Right.
This is garbage. You can make it say whatever you want. Go to 1 Corinthians 6, actually. The Bible says in 1 Thessalonians 5, abstain from all appearance of evil. The NIV says reject every kind of evil. It's vague. The King James Bible says, hey, you should abstain from all appearance of evil. If it looks evil, stay away. The King James or the NIV says, just reject evil. Well, who would disagree with that? Who would disagree? Don't do bad. That's what these modern versions are like. Look at 1 Corinthians 6:18. Flee fornication. Every sin that a man doeth is without the body, but he that committeth fornication sinneth against his own body. That's pretty clear. Fornication is intercourse before marriage. Let's read the NIV. Flee from sexual immorality. Here's my question. What does that mean? You're using a slinky.
Yeah, right.
You get to determine what it is. Well, is it this wide or this tall? It's 4 links, it's 5 links. Everybody has their own interpretation. But you know what? When you use the measuring tape, there's no arguing. Now, you could reject it. I mean, you could just say, well, we don't live in America, so we're not going to use inches. We're going to use meters or something. But you can't reject the fact that that's the authority. That's why it's so important to understand why we have every word of God. Go to Hebrews chapter 4. Bible says, for the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even the dividing of asunder of soul and spirit, of the joints and marrow, and is a discerner and thence of the intents of the heart. The Bible says in Ecclesiastes 1:15, that which is crooked cannot be made straight, and that which is wanting cannot be numbered. So now what if I took this perfectly nice slinky and I went ahead and just kind of bent it like this? Now, here's my question. Can you ever get this back to the original shape? I mean, anybody that's had a slinky before knows. Once it's done, it's done. You know, that's what these modern versions are like. You can't keep fixing it. They keep updating the NIV. You know what they do? They just keep putting more dent marks into it. You know, and eventually, when it's all just dented up and scratched, it looks like the Message, doesn't it? It's just complete trash. You can't even tell what it is anymore. It's just junk. Go to 1 Timothy 3. I want to show you a few more points. The Bible says in Proverbs 3, trust in the Lord with all thine heart, and lean not on thine own understanding, and all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy paths. That verse is impossible if you don't have the King James Bible. Impossible. Because you're not having the authority be the Bible, it's you. How can you trust in the Lord with all your heart if you have every word of God? If you have every word of God, then you can say, you know what, this is my final authority.
Amen.
Whatever it says, I'm going to believe. But when you have the NIV, the ESV, the NASB, the Bible of the Month Club, you're your final authority. It's clear. And you know what? You don't believe that verse. You can't tell me you believe that God's given you every single word to live by if you use the NIV. You just don't believe the Bible.
Mm-hmm.
So let's look at a few other versions. See some doctrines that they just destroy. 1 Timothy 3 verse 1, this is a true saying. If a man desire the office of a bishop, he desireth a good work. A bishop then must be blameless, the husband of one wife, vigilant, sober, of good behavior, given to hospitality, apt to teach, not given to wine, no striker, not greedy of filthy lucre, but patient, not a brawler, not covetous. Now there's a Bible translation called the New Living Translation. Should be the New Lucifer Translation. This thing is the most wicked of all of them, in my opinion. It changes so many doctrines. And here's a doctrine that affects a few people, drunkenness. You know what? It takes the word sober and just throws it away. It gets rid of it. It made it really clear in chapter 2, you're supposed to be sober. Here's what it says in the NLT. So a church leader, I don't know who that is, must be a man whose life is above reproach. He must be faithful to his wife. He must exercise self-control. Self-control. What does that mean? I mean, you know, all these moderate drinkers, all these people that say they do social drinking, they would say they exercise self-control, wouldn't they? They're not being rebuked by that verse. But there's no misunderstanding what sober means.
Right.
If you ask a drunk what sober means, they're going to say, not affected by alcohol at all. Zero. Go to Titus chapter 2. It says in 1 Timothy 3, even so must their wives be grave, not slanderers, sober, faithful in all things. NLT says exercise self-control there again. Titus chapter 2, verse 4, that they may teach the young women to be sober, to love their husbands, to love their children. NLT, these older women must train the younger women to love their husbands and their children. So they said, love their husbands. Do we have that in the King James Bible? Yep. They say, and their children. Do we have that? Yep. What about the sober? Just gone. They just take it out. You can't even defend, to somebody that uses this Bible that drinking's wrong. Because they have a slinky. It's a crooked slinky. It's been deformed. They don't even understand. You got to get them on the King James Bible first.
Amen.
You know what it says in Matthew chapter 3 in the NLT? Repent of your sins and turn to God, for the kingdom of heaven is near. It says in Matthew 3:8, prove by the way you live that you have repented of your sins and turned to God. It says in Matthew 4:17 of the NLT, from then on Jesus began to preach, repent of your sins and turn to God, for the kingdom of heaven is near.
Yeah.
Mark 1:15, the NLT says, the time promised by God has come at last. He announced, the kingdom of God is near. Repent of your sins and believe the good news. That's not good news.
Nope.
Hey, be perfect so you can go to heaven. That's not good news. You're just damning everybody to hell. Acts chapter 3:19, now repent of your sins and turn to God so that your sins may be wiped away. Now, to my knowledge, there's only one English translation that uses the phrase repent of your sins. It's the NLT. It uses it 8 times. The only other book is the Book of Mormon.
Right.
I'll read for you from the Book of Mormon because this is just silly. It says, behold, their husbands love their wives. He's talking about people that are not Mormon. He's saying, he's rebuking the Mormons saying other people, they love their wives more than you, which is true. And their wives love their husbands, and their husbands and their wives love their children. And their unbelief and their hatred towards you is because of the iniquity of their fathers. Wherefore, how much better are you than they in the sight of your great Creator? Oh, my brethren, I fear that unless you repent of your sins, that their skins will be whiter than yours when you shall be brought with them before the throne of God. You know what the Book of Mormon teaches? That how clean you are on the inside, your righteousness toward God, is determined on your skin color. So when you go out in the summer and get a tan, it's because you're sinning really bad. That's why they were so racist for so many years. They hated black people. They taught that black people were the worst sinners. That's not what the Bible teaches. That's wicked. Go back to Isaiah chapter 30. If you don't have a perfect Bible, you don't have an authority. That's why it's so important. But the Bible claims to be the Word of God. It's accessible as the Word of God. It's preserved as the Word of God, isn't it? This King James Bible's never changed one word ever since it was translated in 1611. Go back and look at the one that we have, a replica, the 1611. Same words. Isaiah chapter 30, verse 8. Now go, write it before them in a table and note it in a book, that it may be for a time to come forever and ever, that this is a rebellious people, lying children, children that will not hear the law of the Lord, which say to the seers, see not, and to the prophets, prophesy not unto us right things, speak unto us smooth things, prophesy deceits, get you out of the way, turn aside out of the path, cause the Holy One of Israel to cease from before us. Wherefore thus saith the Holy One of Israel, because ye despise this word, and trust in oppression and perverseness, and stay thereon. You know what? People that don't use the King James Bible, they don't want to. They want the deceits. They want the lies. Why? So that they can trust in themselves. So they can be their own authority. Anybody that has an honest heart and wants to know God's word, it's right here. The King James Bible. Every word of God.
Amen.
It claims to be the Word of God. It's accessible as the Word of God. It's preserved as the Word of God. And don't believe Satan's lie. This is the epic battle. Yea, hath God said. And Jesus answered him, saying, it is written that man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word of God. Let's close in prayer. Thank you, Father, so much for giving us your Word of God, making it plain unto us, giving it to us, making it so accessible, and preserving it unto us. Thou shalt preserve it. I pray that everyone in this room, that with an honest heart, we would just decide to put all of our trust in your words and not our own. That we wouldn't lean on our own understanding, but in all our ways we acknowledge you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
You know, the Bible's really clear on salvation. It's not based on how good you are. A lot of people think they're pretty good, you know, and yeah, they're going to get to heaven because they're pretty good. But the Bible says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. The Bible says, as it is written, there is none righteous, no, not one. I'm not righteous, you're not righteous. And if it were our goodness that would get us into heaven, none of us would be going.